All right, all right. Well. How's everyone doing this Friday? This is Todd, and I am broadcasting you live from Black Spaces Studios. I hope things are treating you well and that you're going to enjoy your Friday evening. I'm here because I want to have a conversation with some friends. With regards to a very serious, almost perplexing movie. Not perplexing, but fascinating, gripping, poignant, yet disturbing film. The film of Civil War. And I'm labeling this Black Spaces episode Civil War 2024. We're going to get into some conversation about that film. It's a film by Alex Garland, and it's imagining what would happen if in fact America had a second Civil War today. So what I'm going to do is have a conversation with you, sort of my various friends and fans. You're not personally my fans, but we have I and a good friend, Sister Toya and Taliba and Naeem and others have built a small following on a group we're calling Black Spaces, which is a science fiction, speculative fiction channel where we talk about things related to science fiction, related to sci-fi. But what we're going to do is kind of have a conversation and sort of discuss in what ways this film is relevant to what's happening in America today. And so what I want to do is I'm going to show a clip that will help us to kind of get some background with regard to this film. And then I'm going to just have some general points of discussion about the film itself. So if you haven't seen the film, if you are kind of wondering what it's all about, I would recommend you go to the theaters and see the film first. And then once you've seen the film, you can then kind of come back and have a conversation about or take a look at this conversation I'm having and critique with regards to this very poignant film. So in other words, this I'm giving you sort of a heads up or a spoiler alert, if you will, with regards to the film. And then you can, again, come back around and check out what exactly, you know, my critique was all about. Okay, so let me start with just a... initial clip, and this was from the Sunday morning show, that I think kind of gives a nice overview of the film. And then we can kind of, I'll get into some points and any questions or comments that you might have as an audience, you can share that and let us know exactly what you're thinking. And we can have a conversation about this whole subject. Okay. So give me a moment while I and my tech guy cue up the clip from the Sunday morning show, and then we'll take it from there.
It's a new movie that imagines what most of us consider unthinkable, yet another American Civil War. But talking with its star, Kirsten Dunst, Ben Mankiewicz asks, what if?
America's darkest chapter has never been far from Hollywood's vivid imagination.
With him goes the last semblance of law and order.
From Gone with the Wind.
The scavengers aren't wasting any time.
Glory.
Worst on the morning.
To Lincoln. Movies have brought us the barbarity and the politics of the Civil War.
I can't accomplish a damn thing of any human meaning or worth until we cure ourselves of slavery and end this pestilential war.
But what if that pestilential war were merely our first Civil War?
Go, 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 go!
That's the premise of a new film called Civil War, opening this week. An unflinching and relentless look.
Well, you're American, okay?
At a nation divided and violent.
What kind of American are you?
Not in the 1860s, but today.
You don't know?
It does not feel like a sci-fi movie. This could be us in, pick a year, 2025, 2026, 2024. Is that fair?
Hopefully not. I mean, but I do think it's a warning. I do.
Kirsten Dunst leads the cast, playing a war photographer. Along with three other journalists, they drive from New York to D.C., hoping to interview the president before rebel forces led by Texas and California reach the White House.
At the heart of all of this, it's really about humanity and what happens when people stop treating each other like human beings.
The lack of humanity in a few scenes is shocking as we follow these reporters along the back roads, encountering an America entirely broken. No rules, no decency.
Who's giving you orders?
And a cold-blooded disregard for human life.
Someone's trying to kill us. We are trying to kill them.
Why is the film unnerving? And I think the obvious reason it would appear to be unnerving is that it's a film about the product of polarization and division.
Alex Garland, an Englishman, is Civil War's writer and director. He leaves unanswered questions of how the war begins and, to some extent, who the good guys are. We're left with a movie that's intentionally vague. Garland wanted this story seen through the eyes of reporters, even though a colleague told him that was box office poison.
They said, don't make a film about journalists. Everybody hates journalists. And I thought that was a really interesting thing to say. It's sort of like saying everybody hates doctors. You can't hate doctors because you need doctors. And actually, any healthy country needs journalists. It needs freedom of the press.
Today, the audience will certainly be talking about the film's president, who we learn is serving a third term and has abolished the FBI.
Some are already calling it the greatest victory in the history of military campaigns.
He's played by Nick Offerman, who says the character was not inspired by any commander-in-chief, past or present. Offerman does say the film offers a warning that, given today's political climate, Americans need to heed.
Our ego and our history wants to allow us to believe that we're above such things that, you know, lesser countries around the world may engage in, but we're Americans, you know. We drink the finest cola beverages. We're immune to such things.
There's an underlying truth with everything difficult, which is nobody's immune.
Are you guys aware there's like a pretty huge civil war going on all across America?
Seeing this happen here is an unsettling experience, one shared by the cast, including Wagner Mora, himself a former journalist, and Kaylee Spaney, two of the three reporters traveling with Kirsten Dunst.
Oh my God, like, why didn't I just tell him not to shoot them?
They're probably going to kill them anyway.
It was the first time that I felt like the message really went through me. You know, it felt like a gut punch, and I came out of it feeling like I want to take action, you know, that I don't want it to ever get to this point.
I'm really making an effort to sit down and listen to people that I disagree. And I was absolutely surprised to see that if you value democracy, if you think that democracy is an important thing, then there are lots of common ground.
And I personally have never felt the way I felt coming out of the theater. And I was in the movie and I was just as shocked. It felt like it was meant to be. I have never had that experience in a film before.
For Kirsten Dunst, that's saying something. She's been in movies since she was a kid, landing her first meaty role at 12.
She's not!
Opposite Tom Cruise and Brad Pitt in Interview with a Vampire.
You want me to get down forever?
Big teen movies followed, The Virgin Suicides and Bring It On, then three Spider-Man films. In 2022, Dunst earned an Oscar nomination for her aching performance in Power of the Dog. Now 35 years into the business, she knows Civil War is unlike anything she's done before.
I'd never played a role like this. I think that this is one of the most important films that I've ever been a part of. I think that it respects the audience and lets them put their own beliefs onto what's happening.
You're saying it's about the audience. What does that mean in this case for this film?
I think it's up to the individual to take whatever their political beliefs are, and they will imprint, watching the film, what it makes them feel, or whose side is what side. And I think that's really interesting, and we'll get a lot of conversations that we need to have happen. And that's the beautiful thing about art. It's like, that's what you want to be a part of in filmmaking, is to push boundaries and give something that no one's seen before. Because I haven't seen a film like this before.
Whatever the audience projects, it will come with a degree of unease in a country that has always been comforted by the notion that this could never happen here, not again.
Unless we come to our senses, our polarized, divisive, non-communicative, accusatory state is going to continue unless we do something about it.
I hope as many people see it as possible, and I hope that it helps us slowly trudge ourselves towards trying to find decency in our society and supporting that and turning our backs on the forces that make us look in the other direction and can lead us to things like what happens in this movie.
That divide us.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So you kind of have a taste then of what's going on, you know, the premise behind why, you know, Alex Garland, you know, created the film, you know, what he thought was important relative to this film. And so let me kind of offer a few of my thoughts about this film and why it's important. Now, it shouldn't be lost on any of us that this film is being produced in 2024, or it's coming out in 2024. It was released a couple of weeks ago in April of 2024. And it's in the midst of a presidential election year, which promises to be a very contentious election year, as you and I both know, given that one of the major candidates for the presidency, and you know, the Republican nominee and the Democratic nominee, you know, both see each other as diametric and polar opposites to each other politically, and in some ways they probably think of each other morally in that sense. So, you know, between Biden and Trump, it is putting it lightly to say there is no love lost, that there's been a whole range of ways in which America is politically polarized. Among my friends and colleagues, you know, one of the hats I wear, probably the biggest hat I wear because it pays my bills, is I'm a political scientist and a scholar who studies questions around race and ethnicity in American politics. So by all sort of major measures, we are sort of quite divided in the American context. And so this film being shown to American audiences and really world audiences in 2024, it is not lost on us as to how this is an allegory of what could be. I will just say in terms of my own sense, and again, I'm going to get into a couple of details. So let me offer sort of spoiler alerts to various folks, because in one sense, I don't want you, if you haven't seen the film, for me to spoil it. But at the same time, I also want you to, if you do want to listen and look and listen to this critique before you go out and see it, then you're welcome to do that. But I'll just sort of say that this film is being seen in a particular context. A film historian and cultural critic by the name of Eric Green talks about this notion in his own work about cultural memory. What is the cultural memory of an audience when they watch a film? And particularly a film, a science fiction film, a speculative fiction film, an alternative history film, such as this film is, what will they be drawing on? So you and I are in the midst, or will be in the midst of a presidential election, if you aren't already, a gripping presidential election. And so it's not lost on us that the very prospect of civil war looms large in the thinking of some. In fact, you know, we have never seen like what we saw in our generation, in our living memory. We've never seen in American life what we saw on January the 6th, 2021, with the storming of the Capitol, of a presidential candidate, an outgoing president, or who some said was outgoing, and the Electoral College said he was outgoing, being exhorting groups of his supporters to come to the Capitol to then protest the counting of the electoral votes. You know, there were some 60 court challenges that the Trump campaign made to the results of the 2020 election. We now know that there are at least four cases and counting with regards to prosecutors raising charges against former President Trump and his campaign with regards to a whole realm of questions that they would call election interfering with the elections. But we also know, of course, that Trump and his campaign is now gearing up for what they see as election integrity on the other side. So there's a sort of what happened as a result of January 6th. Still, probably Americans may want to forget it in some regards, but it still kind of looms large. So this film is being shown in that context. Now, I will say that if you're thinking with regards to what Alex Garland offers in this film, he talks about this idea of the, you know, that he is trying to construct a story that's in between the lines of the obvious politics. So I'll get into that in just a moment. But he's kind of providing a film that is malleable. It's a text that's malleable because you don't know why the Civil War started. This 2024 Civil War started. You don't know why, for instance, the state of Texas and the state of California have joined together as a insurgent, rebellion that has, or secessionist movement that has split off from the United States and are now part of the Western forces are constructing the Western forces. When we think about Texas and California politically, you know, at least in terms of the ideological and party lines, those two states currently are in two different camps. But and then you have sort of this swath of states called the Florida Alliance, which is basically most of, although not all of, the old 11 states of the Confederacy, minus Texas and minus a few others. Then you have sort of the loyalist states. And then you have sort of the northern tier of states that are sort of Maoist or Marxist influence. So it's a whole hodgepodge of things that Alex Garland, as the director and producer of this movie, has put together. And so you don't know why the war started. You don't know, you know, why in effect we've got to this America where you would have this dictatorial president, this authoritarian president who's now served three terms. And any casual perusal of the Constitution now suggests that you can only serve two terms ever since the terms of Franklin Roosevelt. You can only serve two terms as president. So he has a third term. He's also eliminated or abolished the FBI, the Federal Bureau of Investigation. So there's a, you don't know why all of this. You just know that you just are dropped in the moment. And then you as the viewer have to kind of figure out what all of this means and sort it out. So you have all of these sort of elements going on. I will argue that part of what I think is really kind of quite intriguing about this film is that it's gut-wrenching. It's powerful. If you don't like a film if you don't like warfare, let me back up, say that differently. If warfare disturbs you, if violence and quite visceral violence disturbs you, this film is probably not for you. And I'm not into gore. I'm not a fan of horror. It freaks me out. But and I could watch this film, but it was quite difficult at times. You just didn't know. True of war, you didn't know when people were going to die. You didn't know what was lurking around each corner. And so the fact that you have sort of these unknowns make this film quite gripping. And I think it is sort of clearly Alex Garland's attempt to make a film that is not divided strictly upon sort of a left-right continuum, but as he says, is divided along a continuum of sort of centrist politics, which would include all those who believe in the rule of law, who believe in a civil society, who believe in some sense of us having a society where individuals are not so divided that they don't believe in some common goals of the republic and some common rules that we all abide by, a constitutional order. That's centrist. And you can be left or right and believed in that sort of those central rules. Then you have sort of the authoritarian, dictatorial, extremist ends. And that's really what Alex Garland is arguing against. So he's arguing against extremism in this film. And so, so one criticism of course of the film is that it is sort of so indeterminate in its politics. And that you, it's like, well, but obviously you're talking about a president, even if you're not talking about the 45th president or President Trump, you're talking about some president, right? And he would argue, no, I'm talking about a future president. Okay. All right. Again, maybe some fans would say, that's splitting hairs. We know who he's talking about. But let's go along for it for a moment. So there's that element to it of all those unknowns. And then there's the sense in this film that there is no, as the Sunday morning program discussed, there is no good guy in this film. There are no good guys. There's just journalists, and it's sort of this travel log of these four journalists traveling to Washington, D.C. Kristen Dunst character of Lee, the Wagner Moura character of Joel, the Kaylee Spain's character of Jesse, and then Stephen McKinney Henderson's character of Sammy. By the way, for my fellow science fiction nerds who love the Dune series, we now have the answer to our question as to why one of the characters that was in Dune 1 is not in Dune 2. And that's Stephen McKinley Henderson's character of Thurfer Hywat. I don't know if that's the answer to it, but I'm like, he's in this film, but he wasn't in Dune. Maybe he was more compelled to be in this film. Anyway. You can post in the chat as to whether or not that's the case. But again, we kind of have, this is, Garland's attempt to sort of say, no matter what we have in a democratic society, we have to have the truth. Isn't it the responsibility of journalists, the Fifth Estate or however you describe them, isn't it their responsibility to get at the truth? And when we don't have a basic acknowledgement of some core facts, aren't we all in trouble in some regards? So, all of this is sort of swirling in the background, if you will, or is central to this film. Now, I will say that some of the work that this film does makes it quite difficult to not think of any context but present day America, not necessarily future America, past and present America, not future America. For instance, there are a couple of references to Charlottesville, Virginia. Charlottesville, Virginia, as these four journalists are traveling from New York, where they experience a terrorist bombing, and they all meet up in a hotel in New York City, which is suffering power cuts because the war has been terribly destructive. It's torn up the highways. You get the sense that hundreds of thousands of people are dead, that there's just utter carnage and so in the midst of all that, there certainly is unreliable power, energy grid, and there's an unreliable ability for Wi-Fi. And so they meet up in this hotel, they make it a pact to travel to DC, because in fact, sort of Lee and Joel want to get the story of the president, who clearly is about to be, rumor has it, he's about to be politically deposed, actually, and he's about to be disposed of too, by the Western forces who are closing in on Washington, D.C. and about to take the Capitol and then destroy what's left of the loyalist forces and to then surround and, as again, spoiler alert, assassinate and kill the president, which they do. Now, as they're traveling, they get to Charlottesville. Now, Charlottesville means a lot of things, but Charlottesville was the scene of that conflict in 2017, that enormous conflict in 2017. Do I have that date right? Is it 2017, 2018? Where, who would be President Trump, said there were fine people on both sides when there were protesters who were trying to take down these Confederate monuments. There were white nationalist protesters on the other side. And as a result of the conflict between these two sides, individuals were harmed by someone running a car through the protesters, someone on the white nationalist side who's a sympathizer on the white nationalist side, running this car through the protesters and killing a young woman. And, and President Trump's words of, there were fine people on both sides, neo-Nazis who were saying, who were using the chant, "The Jews shall not replace us," as well as the other protesters who were just as bad. And so this was the spark of Joe Biden saying that he would get into the race, or eventually would get in. He would eventually argue that this is the reason why he got into the presidential race in 2020, 19, and then into 2020, Democratic nomination, and then to the presidential contest between the two parties. So Charlottesville represents a literal place of warfare. Certainly Charlottesville goes back to Civil War times as well, but it's the most recent, is one of those recent places where we have fought and continue to fight the Civil War. And it's at Charlottesville that they make sort of the Charlottesville is the goal, because they can't go directly to DC. The highways are mined and torn up. So they have to go to Charlottesville, and Charlottesville is the major staging ground for the Western Front, where they will be embedded with some other reporters as they go into DC. So you can't escape that has something to do, that Charlottesville of this dystopian America has something to do with the conflicts we have today. And again, I've talked about the Nick Offerman character as the president. No, he isn't a Trump, but he is authoritarian. He isn't Trump in the sense of all the manifestations or all of the ways of the personality of Trump, but he is, as some of Trump's sort of critics would certainly argue, and I know there's a divide in America. I'm very aware there's a divide, but he is sort of authoritarian in that sense, which of course Trump's critics accuse him of being as well. So you have all these things going on that are clearly aspects of present day America. You have, the character, who was it, Jesse? I'm sorry, was it Jesse Fleming? You can tell me in the chat, but they, you know, they get, they were having, so the four characters are traveling to DC. Then part of the way there, they meet two reporters who are good friends and are based out of Hong Kong, Tony and Bohai. And they're having a playful exchange on the highway, a dangerous playful exchange where they're driving down the highway and opening the windows and trying to climb in between the cars. Almost gave me a heart attack. But then, and so the young photographer, Jesse, who sees Lee as her mentor, that's the reason why she wants to join the group, you know, that Joel objected to, is like, what the hell are you doing? And then Sammy sort of says, well, why not? Why not have this young 23-year-old Jonas? How else would she learn? So she climbs into the other car, they go up the road, and then the car is abandoned. And you get a feeling in the pit of your stomach, like we all do, to say, well, what the heck happened? The car is empty. And then you see the two of them, and Sammy warns them not to go investigate, and yet they do. And so Joel and Lee and Tony go to investigate, and they see Bohai and they see Bohai and Jesse on the ground with these guys with these guns, who are clearly part of some military force. But they're dumping these bodies into a mass grave and then sprinkling, you know, elements upon these bodies in order for this mass grave. And you just get this pit and you feel in the pit of your stomach, something is ugly about to go down here. Well, it does. It goes down quite ugly. And so sort of the lead soldier sort of very casually asked them, what are they doing here? And what type of Americans are you? That's a question we're asking today. What type of American are you? Are you on my side or on their side? And so, you know, Lee gives the right answer, you know, though shaken. She's from Missouri. Joel gives the right answer. He's from Florida. And possibly these guys are from the Florida Alliance. But of course, Bohai and Tony, being from Hong Kong, gives the right wrong answer and are shot dead on the spot and dumped in. And so, you know, this whole question about ultra nationalism and sort of racism or folk have used, you know, and I just used the term recently of white nationalism, you know, either you are a good blooded American, I'll just say it, folks, a white American in some people's view, or you're not a good American at all. This certainly speaks to this question around racism and racial conflicts in America today. It speaks around conflicts around immigration. It speaks around racial and political violence. I mean, there's a lot wrapped up into that ugly, brutal scene. And we don't have to think about a future America. We can think about, unfortunately, some present day sort of political violence and some racial violence, as well as, not long ago. And certainly some of what has happened during the pandemic and the conflicts that have happened, events this. Then there's one other scene I'll kind of bring on here. And then again, feel free if you're watching this, currently, or if you're watching it, after the broadcast, feel free to post comments. But then we kind of have this sense about the Western forces taking over the Capitol, and they get into the city, and you have this street, this fight, this combat, block by block, street by street, and certainly, you know, the conflicts in Afghanistan, other military conflicts today, all events by this urban warfare, right? And you don't have to go too far back in American history or in world history at all to be talking about the ugly brutality of urban warfare. And the urban warfare is the capital of these United States. Washington, D.C. is under siege. And you see these forces trading bullets in Washington, D.C. one scene of all the sort of brutality, all of the, and I don't say it's needless brutality, although it was extremely hard to watch. You know, it's warfare. So I don't think Garland went out of his way much. Maybe there's a few scenes he did, but I don't think he went out of his way much in what he was showing. But I do think there's one scene where the Western alliances are fighting block by block, street by street in the Washington Mall, and particularly have these, you know, sort of Humvees and various, you know, sort of military vehicles and these choppers flying around the great monuments of the Republic, including the Lincoln Memorial. And they begin to exchange fire. The forces begin to exchange fire at the base or inside the Pantheon and outside the Pantheon of the Lincoln Memorial. And someone just decides, hey, we're going to take them out, and fires anti-personnel, anti-tank, a bazooka that is fired into and blast one of the pillars, one of the pylons of the Lincoln Memorial. And you see the building burst into flames. And I have to admit, sometimes you don't know how things will affect you, but the imagery of the Lincoln Memorial, and we know that Abraham Lincoln was as a complicated figure, like all great figures in political history. And this idea that he was this sort of, Lincoln at best was, as we know, is sort of a reluctant emancipator. But I would say that Lincoln was one of the great American presidents, even given, you know, his complicated history. And, you know, we can get into that, and we can post in the chat about that with regards to Lincoln. Being that as it may, taking down this great memorial, this great monument of the Republic, to remind us of how the last Civil War, which killed, you know, more than a million men and women, you know, took out 500,000 people, at a time when we're talking about the nation that constituting a huge percentage of the nation of both North and South, so no family was left untouched by this. Seeing the Lincoln Memorial in flames kind of spoke deeply to me, and I almost teared up a little, just a little. And so, to me, what this film does in a very poignant way is convey all of these, all of the depths of these emotions, and conveys all of these conflicts and contradictions that we confront today. And so, I wanted to kind of just offer a few words of commentary about it. I'm going to encourage you to go check it out for yourself. If you're watching this on broadcast, you know, after this live stream, feel free to post some comments, and I'll be responding to the comments across the platforms. Let me encourage you to, if you haven't already, consider liking or joining us with Black Spaces. We have a Black Spaces invitation page where we discuss sort of films and movies and sometimes books and the Black and people of color presences in movies and films and television shows. And then we have a Black Futures page, Facebook page. Both of these are Facebook pages. And on that Black Futures page, which is open to the broader public, we discuss a whole range of things related to Black presences in science fiction. And then we have our YouTube channel, which is open to all to subscribe to. And across all of our platforms, we at Black Spaces talk about providing a unique critique. We love science fiction at Black Spaces. We like speculative fiction. We like alternative history. We like a lot of funky stuff that deals with past and present. But we want to provide critiques about, well, what's the social and political and economic ramifications of what we see. Films are about messages. And certainly our discussion today about Civil War is evident about how film, how art, how stories can be powerful, provide us with powerful allegories to have us think. And so I'll say this in conclusion with regards to Civil War. I would say that, yes, it is a film that we ought to discuss and not discuss. And yes, I do think we should discuss it from what Garland offers as his motive for creating this film, which is to say, not for us to believe this could not happen again, for us to be disabused of the notion that, you know, everything is normal and we could never have another civil war. Well, we had a first one and there is sort of stark polarization in America today. Now, I'm not arguing that we're quite in the same spot, and historians would tell us you are not in the same spot, but we do want to kind of be mindful of the fact that it's possible for history to at least rhyme, if not repeat itself. But the other thing I want us to discuss in this film is to kind of think about the elements that could be filled in, and filled in ways that are not a civil, outright military civil war, not a dystopian and sort of destructive, almost, you know, cataclysmic, almost apocalyptic version of a civil war, but small civil wars, tiny civil wars that may continue into the future because of the unresolved conflicts, because of the consensus we can't derive, because aspects of politics are broken and maybe broken in ways that some people wanted to be broken, but that we do have these sort of fundamental dividing lines, you know, of race, of gender, of class, across a whole realm of considerations, and that maybe normal politics as we understand them won't get us back to where we're thinking. What do we have to do beyond this? Some suggest third party candidates, some suggest not voting at all, some suggest protest. You know, there are a range of questions within a republic that's committed to greater inclusion and democracy. What might we do to avoid the small civil wars as well as the large cataclysmic civil wars? So I'll leave that with you. I appreciate you watching this broadcast of a deep dive or a live deep dive into 2024 Civil War. I'm Todd. Again, like, share, and subscribe to keep Black Spaces alive and to help us thrive. And as we say at Black Spaces, and as always my sign off, as though I'm Don Cornelius from the 1970s, we'll catch you on the backhand side, on the black hand side, and in the future. Thank you much.